Good morning, class. In the previous classes, we have completed our most of the topics from this chapter. That was the fundamental unit of life, which is cell. So before moving with the last portion of this chapter, I'll give you a very brief recap of whatever we have studied till now. First of all, we have studied what is cell. Cell was the structural and functional unit of life. That was the very much basis of life. Without the cell, the life on earth will not be possible. Then the two types of organisms divided on the basis of the number of cells they contain, that is the unicellular and the multicellular. Unicellular consists of just one cell. On the other hand, multicellular have many cells. So as unicellular consists of only one cell, all the functions are performed by that particular cell, but in multicellular, the different functions are performed by different cells. Then we studied the nucleus, and then organisms were divided on the basis of the presence or absence of nuclear membrane. So the prokaryotes were the more primitive one, and they do not contain the nuclear membrane, and their nucleus was called as nucleoid, whereas the eukaryotes, or the true nucleus containing organism, U means true, they consist of a particular nuclear membrane, and the full-fledged nucleus was present in the center. The presence of nucleus is very much important, as it is the controlling body of the cell. Then we studied the difference between the animal as well as the plant cell, and we studied 10 or 15 differences between the two. So in the last class, we were discussing about the cell organelles. The cell organelles are the main components of the cell that are attributed to perform different functions, and they are mostly floating in the cytoplasm of the cell. Nucleus is also a cell organelle, and it is the most important cell organelle. So this is the structure of a cell. The plasma membrane, we discussed the plasma membrane and the kind of transport it does, that was the facilitated, as also called as the active transport. And the second one was diffusion, which comes under the category passive transport or the passive diffusion. So diffusion was without any energy or without any using of ATP, but the active transport, it utilized ATP because it has to cross a certain gradient. A gradient is something that is formed when there is a difference in the concentration on two sides. So plasma membrane was also called as a semi-permeable membrane because it allows only some particle or only some fluid to pass through it, whereas the cell wall, which was a completely permeable, and it was present in only plant cells. Cell wall was rigid, and that's why it gives a peculiar shape to the plant cell, whereas plasma membrane has no peculiar shape. Then we discussed the different parts of the cell. So these were the main parts: the plasma membrane, which is the outermost covering of the cell, the nucleus, the central or the master organ or organelle of the cell, then cytoplasm, the fluid which is present in the cell, and it contains all the important cell organelles floating in it. The most important, nucleus. So let's discuss nucleus in a little brief. It is the most prominent and large organelle. It is houses or most of the cell's DNA. So houses means it consists of most of the DNA in it. Most of the DNA, but not all. Now I'll tell you where the other part of DNA is present. But for now, you just know that most of the, that is 80% of part of the DNA is present inside the nucleus. It contains genes. Genes is the basic unit of heredity, and genes are the ones that get transferred from generation to generation. Then it controls the activity of other organelles. What is the structure of nucleus? It is a spherical or oval shaped structure. Then most cells have a single nucleus, although there are some cells which on maturity do not have nucleus. I told you two examples. In animals, it was RBCs that are devoid of any nucleus. That's why they could not sustain for a longer period of time, and the duration of them was only 120 days. And plant cells, the sieve tube cells, were the ones that were containing no nucleus. And it is also a condition when many nucleus are present. It is called syncytial in animals as well as cenocytic in plants. Then it consists of a nuclear membrane. The membrane which is surrounding the nucleus, it is continuous and without any rough endoplasmic reticulum. Then the nuclear pores. Nuclear pores, it is also called as the nuclear pore complex. Complex words come from, it contains many proteins also, and the structure of the nuclear pore complex is very much complex. That's why it is called as the nuclear pore complex, and the study of this will be in very much higher classes. Then each nuclear pore consists of circular arrangement of proteins surrounding a large central opening. This opening of the nuclear pore helps in the exchange of materials between the nucleus and the cytoplasm. Now, we'll discuss, this is also the diagrammatic picturization of nuclear pore. This is nuclear pore. These are the proteins and surrounding a central cavity. The reticulum or the endoplasmic reticulums are attached to the outer walls of the nucleus, and these are mainly for providing the framework to the cell. Framework means a particular structure to the cell. It don't allow the nucleus to the ribosomes. Ribosomes are the sites of protein synthesis. These are the tiny organelles that reflects their high content of ribosomal RNA. The RNA is of three types. Then comes, they are the site where they are present. They are either attached to the rough endoplasmic reticulum, or they are floating freely in the cytoplasm. On the rough endoplasmic reticulum, they are present on particular position, but in cytoplasm they can float easily anywhere. It consists of two subunits, the larger subunit. This is the larger subunit and this is the smaller subunit. It is denoted by a constant that is called S. So in human beings, it is present 80S, the larger subunit, and 70S, the smaller subunit. S refers to the Swedberg constant. These both combine together and forms a complete functional ribosome. Now comes the endoplasmic reticulum. Endoplasmic reticulum is present attached to the nuclear membrane. This one is the rough endoplasmic reticulum. As you can see, the ribosomes attached on its surface, and this is the smooth endoplasmic reticulum. There are no ribosomes present. The function of rough endoplasmic reticulum is the formation of protein mainly, but smooth endoplasmic reticulum performs two main functions, that is, first one is formation of fat and other one is detoxification in the liver. Then comes the Golgi bodies. The main function of Golgi bodies is the processing as well as packaging of the proteins that were provided to it by the endoplasmic reticulum. So that's a chain. The materials being synthesized in the nucleus, that comes to the endoplasmic reticulum by the pores. Then endoplasmic reticulum transfers that material to the Golgi bodies, and here the processing and packaging occurs. Processing, first the entry of the whatever material is being formed by the endoplasmic reticulum takes place from the entry phase, that is the cis phase. It is also called the forming phase. Then whatever processing takes place in these coil-like structures, it is being transferred to the vesicles. It also contains three types of vesicles, the secretory, membrane, as well as the transport vesicle. This transport vesicle is useful in transferring whatever has been packaged to the other body parts or other cell organelles. So the main function of Golgi complex is packaging, and it is present in a perfect position in animal cell, whereas in plant cell it is scattered somewhere in the cytoplasm, and it is called dichotome in plant cells. Then mitochondria. This is where we have to start in this class. Till Golgi bodies we have studied in the previous class. What are mitochondria? First of all, let's discuss their nature and occurrence. The mitochondria, the singular for mitochondria is mitochondrion. So it is a term that is plural. The mitochondria are the tiny bodies. They are of varying shapes. Shapes can be cylindrical, rod shape, or spherical, and the size varies from 0.2 millimeter to 2 millimeter. They are also distributed in the cytoplasm. Each mitochondrion is bounded by a double membrane. This is the double membrane. First membrane, and then inside you can see another membrane. So inner membrane as well as the outer membrane. Then outer membrane, it is porous, whereas the inner membrane is thrown into folds, and this is the folds of the inner membrane. These are called cristae. Because the folds are there in the inner membrane, the length of the inner membrane is very much large as compared to the outer membrane. It is only in a simplified form. Then the folds which are present here contain some dots. These are folds, are also called as cristae. The dots, these are the F1 particles. F1 particles are also called the oxysomes. These are the round bodies. The interior cavity of this mitochondria contains a proteinaceous gel-like structure or matrix, which is fluid. So the fluid of chloroplast was called stroma, and the fluid of mitochondria is called matrix. This contains a few small-sized ribosomes also, and also one circular DNA. So I told you that much of the percent of DNA is present in the nucleus, but that remaining 20% is somewhat found in the mitochondria, and some amount is found in the chloroplast. So that's why they are able to self-replicate, and these are also called as the semi-autonomous organelles. Then the functions. What are the functions of mitochondria? Mitochondria are the sites of cellular respiration. They use molecular oxygen from air to oxidize the carbohydrates and fats present in the cell, and then they convert it to carbon dioxide and water vapor. I have told you the photosynthesis process, or you must have read in earlier classes, in a very much simplified way, carbon dioxide and water combines to form glucose. But in respiration, the opposite occurs. In this, the complex carbohydrates break down into simple ones, that is inorganic carbon dioxide and water vapor. Oxidation releases energy, a portion of which is used to form ATP. So main function of mitochondria is the formation of ATP, and ATP is the energy currency of the cell, and it is utilized in various functions of the cell. ATP stands for the organic compound adenosine triphosphate, and it is generally known as the energy carrier or energy currency of the cell. It is a common fuel, that is, it is used to drive numerous energy requiring processes of the cells, like active transport in plasma membrane is also done with the help of ATP. The body of an organism uses the energy stored in ATP. What is that energy used for? It is used for the synthesis of chemical compounds, for example, in the process of DNA replication, transcription of RNAs, and synthesis of proteins, carbohydrates, and lipids. And the second one is mechanical work. The mechanical work includes the contraction of molecules, that is, the molecules that are present in the body, they use ATP for contraction of the muscles. They are used for movement, locomotion, as well as peristalsis. Peristalsis is the movement of food inside the esophagus or the food pipe to reach into the stomach. Movement of cilia, flagella, conduction of nerve impulse, and production of heat, all this requires ATP. So mitochondria are able to make some of their own proteins, so they are also called as a semi-autonomous organelles because of the presence of DNA. A detailed structure with label diagram. Then we come to lysosome. Lysosome are called the societal bags because they contain some hydrolytic enzymes. Hydrolytic enzymes are those which are acidic, and their pH is somewhere around 4.5 to 5. These digest the cells, or digest means cause the death of those cells which are worn out. Worn out means which have got damaged. They also helps in fertilization. Some disorders are caused by faulty, or if the lysosome is not absent, that is the Niemann-Pick disease and the Gaucher's disease. Then comes the peroxisomes. So peroxisomes are also very important cell organelle. The nature and occurrence of these are small in size, mostly from 0.3 to 1.5 millimeter in diameter, and spherical organelles containing powerful oxidative enzymes. The oxidative enzymes are those which causes oxidation of any compound. They are bounded by a single membrane. Peroxisomes are mostly found in kidney and liver cells. Inner contents of peroxisomes are finely granular, but sometimes they are crystalline and visible with the help of microscope, and they are mostly present in the center. As they are very small, the center is occupied by these crystalline or granular contents. दिस क्रिस्टलाइन कोर इज अ क्रिस्टलाइज प्रोटीन कॉल्ड कैटेलेज एंजाइम. सो द कैटेलेज एंजाइम इज हेल्पफुल इन कैटालिसिस और कैटालिसिस मीन्स इन एनहेंसिंग द एक्टिविटी ऑफ मेनी reaction. So this catalase enzyme is very much useful in performing the various reactions that take place in our body continuously. So the structure is similar to lysosomes, but they are little smaller in size than the lysosomes. They contain several oxidases, enzymes that can oxidize various organic substances. The functions are degradation of amino acids, oxidation of long chain fatty acids. Degradation means they break down the amino acids in more simplified forms. Peroxisomes are also specialized for carrying out some oxidative reactions such as detoxification or removal of toxic substances from the body. Detoxification is a very important process that many cell organelles do so as to remove out everything that is not useful or that can be harmful for our body. The dysfunction of peroxisome leads to the syndrome that is called the Zweiger syndrome, and you have to learn all this important diseases that are caused due to the deficiency of some cell organelles. Then the cytoskeleton. Cytoskeleton provides the framework to the cell. That is, without the cytoskeleton, the cell will not be able to achieve its state of round, that is round in shape. So a network of protein filaments that extends throughout the cytoplasm. It is in the form of network. Mainly there are of three types: the microtubules, intermediate tubules, and the microfilaments. What are the microtubules? These are hollow, unbranched, and polar cylinder-like structures. They are made up of protein tubulin. So tubulin is a type of protein. These are made up of tubulin, and the two types of tubulin are the alpha as well as beta tubulin. These are the largest of the cytoskeletal components. I told you there are three: the microtubules, intermediate filaments, and the microfilaments. The microtubules are the biggest in the cytoskeleton family. Then the microfilament, these are the thinnest, and these are the elements of the cytoskeleton composed of protein, actin. That were the microtubules are made of tubulin, and these are made up of actin. Mostly the concentration is just of protein. Only the difference is the type of protein present in them. Most abundant intracellular protein that the concentration just under the plasma membrane. These are concentrated just under the plasma membrane so that plasma membrane do not lose its size, because I told you plasma membrane do not have any rigid shape. That's why for maintaining its shape, these are present just below the plasma membrane. These are most prevalent at the edges of the cell. Edges means the sides of the cell. Now, function is to mechanical support for the basic strength and shapes of the cell. And microfilaments are also involved in muscle contraction, cell division, and cell locomotion. So, this was all for today. Now, your chapter is ended. We'll discuss.